that the paper would also be minimized. Yes, definitely we also appreciate and we also want that at all the time the paperwork should always be minimal. Though it would be a dream to be a paperless office in the government sector, because you know we are governed by various audits and various checks and balances, which does not allow us to make it a paperless. Though we would wish that it should become a paperless, but nevertheless, with the portal in place, a lot of paperwork has reduced, and we'll still pursue, and we are we'll pursue to see that the further reduction of the paperwork is done, so that, and more so with this pandemic of coronavirus, it could also be in the right earnest that further lessening of the paperwork would help in ease of doing business to all of us. Secondly, thirdly was regarding the DBT and L1 and L2. These are also because of the government policy that we cannot segregate amongst the small scale vendors or the startups, if that with the already developed people, because we have to also follow the state policies wherein we need to encourage the startups as well as the small and medium sector, even if they are not experienced. Yes, there are ways and means how we can do that, and I think the GNL in their new tender is also doing that by allowing the new startups and the small and inexperienced person to participate, but their financial bills are to consider. So that is also one way to safeguard their own interest as well as the interest of the new entrants. Now, coming back to your issue with Mr. George, you did mention of the portal. The portal has also definitely been a boon, because we know that when we started way back in 2017 or 18, in the beginning, 17 I would say, the first program in fact started in late 16. And it was a nightmare implementation of the solar rooftop program without a portal, because so many issues, so many agencies, so many organizations, and so many people to respond to. It was a very difficult and uphill task, and without this portal, I'm sure that this program would not have been implemented in the way it is implemented now. Before the GIZ portal was in place, we did work with another portal which was locally developed, but that was not as user-friendly as was subsequently developed with the help of GIZ. But it is always experience sharing, because we keep on learning every day. Learning is an unending process. Even with the today's portal, there could be certain issues or features which can always be added to bringing in more ease of operation to all the people, not only the applicants, but the EPCs, the government sector, the DISCOMs, and all of us. So I would certainly say that the portal has been a boon, and I thank especially ZSZ and Gold, Mr. George Gabler, for supporting and helping Gujarat Energy Development Agency and subsequently the GNL for development of this portal. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Patel. As a follow-up question, it is always the notion now in these panels when we talk about rooftop in different states, rooftop related to subsidies. Yeah, the subsidies are now with the phase two program at MNRE, and only target the residential sector, assuming that the commercial industrial sector is standalone. So no governmental intervention is possible. It is always it comes across as a notion that the state nodal agencies now don't play an important role as you used to in the past, since the disbursement of subsidy and additional incentives are going directly to the DISCOMs and DISCOM organizations. I would like to change that notion and speak to you about it. I publicly offered you also now this new program where we're doing the upskilling of labor among your installer base in Gujarat. As a new program which is already commissioned, we just have to get it implemented. So can you also tell us, and we have, I don't know if we have the 1,000 people in the audience, I cannot see it, but we have several hundred people out there listening to you. Can you tell us the role of a state nodal agency in phase two subsidy of MNI?
Can you say it again, the last one, Mr. Joe?
Yes. How do you see the role of a state nodal agency in the phase of Srishti scheme, MNIE, DISCOM relationship? What is, where can you say state nodal agency is of importance and will remain of importance the way we see it?
Hello, as far as the residential rooftop program is concerned, probably because the MNRE felt that it was true in case of many of the states, except few states, including Gujarat, where the DISCOMs were not wholeheartedly on the board for the implementation of the rooftop is concerned. Probably that was one of the major reasons why the MNRE wanted the residential rooftop sector to be brought under the ambit of the DISCOMs. And that was the right move also, so that unless you own a program, you won't work for it. And therefore, I think it has shown the results also. When we were implementing the program, though of course it was the initial phase and it was the very preliminary stages of implementation, but the difference can be seen that during the last 6 months, or say from the September to about March, about 6 months, a good amount of work has been done. So significant amount of reason could be attributed of the fact because now the DISCOMs are made to monitor themselves. So therefore, the pace of implementation would increase. But nevertheless, that does not reduce the role of the nodal agency. There are sectors other than the residential also. As I said earlier, that the total cumulative installed capacity in Gujarat, as far as rooftop is concerned, is close to 536 megawatt, of which, even if you take out about 300 megawatt of domestic, there are about 200-250 megawatt of commercial, industrial, and other sectors that has been done. And for that, JEDA is nodal agency, and we are playing our role in that. Besides that, there are other programs as well. For example, the decentralized solar systems of half a megawatt to 4 megawatt. Though, of course, I would say that, of course, though the policy is there in place since more than a year now, but because of the rate probably which people felt was not very economically viable, so the government is also rethinking on that as well. And but for this pandemic situation in the last 45 days, otherwise that could have been concluded by that by now as well. And added to that, we are also the nodal agency for the component A of the KUSUM, which would also significantly increase the solar base in the state, which would allow capacities from half a megawatt to 4 megawatt under the state policy, and from half a megawatt to 2 megawatt under the KUSUM. So definitely the state nodal agency has a role to play, and I would happy to accept the assistance that GIZ is going to provide through their new program, and we would be more than happy to get associated with you with your experience sharing. That would be helpful in taking further the cause of development of renewable energy sector in the state of Gujarat. And I'm sure that with the new regulation that is in place, the tariff order which the regulator has already approved and announced last week. But for this pandemic, the Gujarat policy, which has lapsed on 31st of March, that was also to be devised afresh or to make it extended, for which a task force was already constituted about 3 months prior to the expiry of the policy, and there were discussions held with the group for the formulation of new policy, and it was on the verge of being finalized, but for this rough weather, after which I am sure that it will be readdressed too, and considering the present situation, some good things could be featured into the new policy. Thank you.
Thank you so much, sir. And also, you are also doing a lot of wind and offshore wind in Gujarat, which is also, again, a forerunner state, but it's not the topic of today's discussion. So I'm a little bit over time. Unless I hear from the organizer, I would maybe give a last round of closing words to the panelists very quick. Something which is burning. I see some hands coming up already, including mine. So please, Mr. Shah, you start. Then we continue with Mr. Shukla, and we hope that the organizer will not interrupt us here. Last one.
Yeah, thanks, sir. In continuation of reducing the paperwork, as I told, there are two major paper which is now we have to submit and we can move away with. One is power purchase agreement. Every customer has to sign power purchase agreement. But the format of that power purchase agreement is more or less, not more or less, it is a common, and the consumer has no right to change any word of it. So instead of signing individually, consumer, while signing his application for rooftop, he can sign the statement that I also agree with the master power purchase agreement of DISCOM and do away with signing a separate power purchase agreement. Number two, there is a requirement of signing a DISCOM paper which is signed jointly by DISCOM person, consumer and installer after installation of solar system. But since now the DISCOMs are handling this project, earlier JEDA was handling the project and this kind of paper was needed to ascertain that yes, definitely the system is commissioned. But now since the DISCOM is handling this project, DISCOM can themselves certify that the system is commissioned and there is no need to jointly sign the paper. So these two are the major concern in this pandemic situation. We are not able to go to customer place or go to DISCOM place to sign, get the sign on those papers, and the huge subsidy has been stuck. So our humble request to authorities as well as MNRE to solve these two major problems and do away with signing the hard copies of the paper rather than can sign it by virtually signing it, we can do away with. So this is the humble request to authorities.
Yeah, just a follow-up question on that, Mr. Shah. Thank you. It seems to be a burning topic also on the questions we receive from the audience. Can you also tell us your best case scenario of receiving the subsidies? So once all the paperwork is submitted, everything is signed, and the system is installed, what would be your perfect scenario of receiving the subsidies without seeing delays? Because cash flow for organizations like yours are important, and I don't even know how you can handle cash flow under 3 to 6 months. I heard up to a year of receiving the incentives or subsidies. You had pre-finance basically.
So best case scenario is one and a half months from submission of all the documents, and worst case scenario is around 8 to 12 months.
Mr. Shukla, I know you have been waiting. Please, the word is yours.
Yeah. So I have one suggestion to support the solar community. The recent tender was for a 600 megawatt for residential rooftop, and it was filled up to 490 or 491 megawatt, and it was stopped. And the government has already announced a new tender of 600 megawatt. So I think that to reduce the burden of the EMTs and the deposits, for the new tender, I think the remaining capacity of the first tender of 600 megawatts should be completed first, and then the new tender should be introduced. I need input of Mr. Shah, sir, and Vinit on this.
Yeah, I agree with your suggestion. So many customers have asked me to raise this point. Thank you, Sanjit, for discussing this. And what they are recommending or requesting is that rather than, I mean, either the first option which you said of including this limit in the new tender, or the better option is to submerge the new tender with the existing guidelines. The channel partners can just give a go ahead whether they are ready with the whole process, because ideally the system is the same, all the procedure remains the same, just that it's a new tender, everyone has to fill up the forms again, fill up the tenders, EMDs again. And when there is a new tender, there is always going to be a fear of new pricing, or then there is a downward trend. Whenever there is a new tender comes up, whether the prices go down or not is a second thing. So people worry that prices might still go down further because of one or two companies just quoting like that what said. Maybe they want to sabotage the whole process, or they don't have the complete knowledge of the incidental expenses. So can we, I don't know, it's a very out-of-box thinking whether we can have the same chance and continue with the same tender and allow new people to join in with the EMDs, but the existing people, can they continue with the same application, EMD, and so on and so forth. That is one thing. Secondly, a small issue which they are all facing is that with the current ECR content requirement, there is a new requirement by the discoms to all the agencies that they have to give a certifying letter that they agree that this is a ECR module. But the problem here is that, or the question is that, all the discoms are already certifying the ECR modules when they do the inspection. Why do they need another certification or self-certification from the agencies again? It is a double process, and it is again going to take time in the subsidy disbursement. And I don't think this process was mentioned in the 10% also. So, these are small things, but they have a huge impact on the market, and they create some different sentiments among the channel partners. And
these are
which many people are asking me. I'm just putting it as a voice for them. Is there going to be a delay in the subsidy disbursement from MNRE to GBNL after this pandemic? Is there a situation like that?
I can speak on that as a closing remark. I have the organizer already with us with a serious face. He wants to finish the panel. We are 10 minutes over time, but I think for Indian standards, we are all fine. you can always go longer and start later. This is, I think, what I learned in India. So MNIE announced, Joint Secretary, I heard him saying that he announced that specifically the disbursement of subsidies to the agencies, number one, and he also created a WhatsApp group where exactly he is putting out the figure which has been transferred. So I think you have a very progressive MNIE. Thank you, panelists. I could continue for another hour because I only have three questions of 10. But Leopold is here from first view. He's very serious. Maybe there's something happening in the audience we don't know. So he looks very serious. So back to you, Leopold. I hope we can start.
Absolutely. So, personally, if you ask me, I had no intention of coming back onto the session because the kind of the kind of flow which you had, I think I'm just an add-on right now. Number two, well, as per Indian standards, yes, which is why we brought in a German moderator. But things are totally the same, even with German moderators, like or not. Alright, so, I think we need to somehow pick up a couple of questions. There's a lot of questions which are poured. I want to compile, as many as possible and just put across these to the panelists. So, we move on to the next phase. The next phase, just to keep our audience updated, we are going to be announcing the elite winners who have given the best ideas yesterday, which we ran, on some of the best mitigation measures for PE development in India. So, we will be announcing those winners. But first now, you know, I'd like to put across a question to Mr. Patil. So, you know, a lot of people want to, first of all, you mentioned about the privacy, it was already provisions were made. So, a couple of points which I'm going to put it together. One of them is, does the new policy have any emphasis on new solutions in the form of storage, or PIPV? That's number one. Number two is, a lot of industries right now might want to go on to solar, mostly COVID, right? This has given a lot of industries or commercialists to think on investment in solar, think on the returns. Are there going to be any special measures, since we have also seen the announcement of Atmanirbhar package yesterday? Are these closely going to be implemented, right? And the third and final solution that I want more of views. I think, you know, in many private organizations, we see all these performance-linked incentives. Do you think it's a right way to link subsidies to the generation instead of just looking at subsidies as standalone, as this might also give importance to installing a quality system? So there are these three points that you could just, you know, summarize them.
Yeah, thank you, Mr. Vipul. As far as the question number one is concerned regarding the storage and the BIP is concerned, as far as storage is concerned, there is a separate policy which is being worked upon under the EV policy where the storage also comes in. But it is not specifically being addressed in the solar policy that is under discussion. But as I said, it is not yet finalized. Such suggestions can always be taken into consideration for their incorporation depending on the view of the entire committee. And BIPV as such is not specifically mentioned, but as long as any application of solar is concerned, I don't think there should be any reason why BIPV should not be allowed under this policy, because it is neither technology agnostic nor any other application agnostic. So, BIPV could also be utilized even if it is not specifically mentioned. But despite that, I will take into consideration during the next discussion of the policy whenever it happens, and would also try to flag these issues so that they can be incorporated if required. Secondly, I didn't get your second question very well. Can you repeat it again?
So my second question is, especially for the C&I segment. Now, I think we firstly will be looking at a lack of funds. So it is quite possible we will be moving to an OPEX model. For a lot of industries. So are there any provisions that are made? Because I think in Gujarat, we also have a lot of textile MSMEs which work around the clock, right? So one option is, do we have any special subsidies so that the consumer does not have to face the burden? Or are there any provisions, let's say, for group capital mechanisms for these MSMEs in Gujarat? That's what I want to understand. How does the CNI now take off in this scenario? Because that is where I think, you know, Vinay or Mr. Shah or Ishan would be, you know, very looking forward to, because ultimately if they have to pass on the burden to the consumers and if they have no incentive, it becomes very difficult. So that's, I want to have your view on this.
See, as far as the MSME is concerned, there is already a policy which was linked to the policy 2015, of course, that is also lapsed. But that would be also taken care of while addressing the new policy, wherein the MSMEs are allowed to set up a capacity of any, irrespective of their contract load, which earlier was restricted to 50%. As far as the other incentives are concerned, I don't think any incentives in terms of cash incentives are required for the capital cost, because all of us agree that over the years the capital cost of the solar project have nosedived. And thirdly, as I said earlier also, there got to be a balance between the DISCOM as well as the between the conventional and the non-conventional power, because one of the panelists also said that Gujarat is one of the best DISCOMs who are making timely payments. And to ensure that they continue to do so, they have to have some balancing acts which are required to be done. As far as the OPEX model is concerned, that is also related to the health of DISCOM. But nevertheless, a point has been made in the policy discussion that to some sectors, the OPEX may be allowed, though it is not yet finalized. But discussions have happened on that, and when the policy is given a final shape, I'm sure that would be addressed to, but I'm not sure whether it would be opened up for all sectors, will be limited to, or will be continued as it was in the earlier policy, not allowing the OPEX model. Because it has its own reasons for the DISCOMs. So, that is the situation as far as the commercial and industrial sectors are concerned. Thirdly, performance-linked incentives, as you said, it is always better that the incentives be linked to the performance. But then, it also causes concerns for the EPC, because once you say that the subsidy will be linked to the performance, then it depends or it delays the further release of the subsidies also. Depending on the performance, then their evaluation, the time required in that. So, therefore, performance-linked incentives, though it sounds good, but then it delays the payments to the EPC also. So that also needs to be figured out.
All right. Thank you. So I'm going to believe in Mr. Shaw on this one. So two quick questions. One is, we've been discussing now, be vocal and then local. So that's the statement we've been hearing. Now, it is not easy for any, Indian company, unless and until it has a background in manufacturing, to start manufacturing. So, I think we have to accept the reality is one of the strongest manufacturing background that India sees. Gujarat has been at the forefront in terms of manufacturing. We have a lot of panel manufacturers, Adani, Goldi, Navitas, a lot of these guys, right? Now, the first question is, do you think, with the PM making statements on after the Atmanirbhar package, except that the relief of, economic fund which has been allocated, does this help, start to look at serious manufacturing in India? Because we've been discussing this the last 2-3 years. It is right now serious for you. A scale of 1 to 10, if you had to put it, how serious is it? And a question to Mr. Shah, which you can address is, some of the smaller installations, let's say 2 kilowatts, 3 kilowatts, 5 kilowatts, they may not be financially viable. So, as an EPC player, when you don't want to, yesterday I heard about, the portable storage solutions, which helps, address the need. How does an EPC company, work on these smaller installations? Just because the past is huge. So we need to start with you at the end of the session.
So, thank you. Thanks for the question. Even before yesterday, Mr. Honorable PM spoke about being independent and self-reliant and all these things. MNRE has been conducting series of similar discussions. How can we promote RE manufacturing in India on a very holistic level, what you said, on a very serious note, not on a secondary level where we only do the final assembly part. The ministry is very much trying to bring the whole ecosystem of solar manufacturing in India, and not mean only the solar panels or just the solar cells. As of now, when we say Indian manufacturing, it is restricted to solar cells and solar panels in India, and now some domestic content modules. Not going to be like that anymore in the coming years. They want the whole ecosystem in terms of the EVAs, the glasses, and the ribbons. all of that which goes into manufacturing the solar panel, first of all, and apart from that, the inverters and the cables and structures. So I think generally the cables are manufactured already in India, but the inverters, very handful of you people are actually making string inverters in India with the complete design and the semiconductor materials. What we are doing as of now is mainly importing all the components from various places and doing the final assemblies of it's made in India. Things like what happens in the solar panels. So definitely there is a very big push for the serious manufacturing in India. But what you said about manufacturing being a very tough job and it's not easy to promote it. So government has to come up with really clean and futuristic policies which are stable in nature, at least a 5-year and a 10-year vision, where if they come out with longer term plans of how do they incentivize manufacturing, I don't say in terms of subsidies, but when you say incentivizing, it is in terms of creating a market, it is in terms of making sure you are restricting imports on a very serious note by imposing various kind of duties or entry barriers, and not specific to a particular countries like China, but what we have seen in the safeguard duty scenario of last 2 years, people have been importing it through various other sources from Vietnam and Thailand and Cambodia and whatnot. So there has to be a very strict entry barrier when you import those materials. I understand WTO comes into picture and it's not easy to implement those policies. We are signed treaties with various such countries in the world. So we have to make a balancing act like what Michael said is talking about, the conventional and non-conventional. Similarly, the government has to make a balancing act between imports versus promoting local. So it's a very tricky situation. Even for the government, it's not easy to promote it with all the restrictions that they have. But definitely, we see a very big intent in last 2 months post-pandemic, and it is going to be a very big opportunity for new entrants in the solar sector. And I think collaboration will be the key in the future. People from Germany, from Europe, from US, or even from China, but for that matter, they will come and set up shops in India. But the complex ecosystem that we have, it's not easy to just buy a piece of land and start manufacturing. They will be looking for local partners in India, not necessarily into the solar sector, but who can understand manufacturing. So even in India, there will be non-solar manufacturers who are doing sizable manufacturing in their own domain. They might get into solar along with a technical partner, or the Indian solar manufacturers will get financing support from various other companies across the world. MNC is looking at Indian manufacturing for the global demand. So this is going to be the key. When they look at manufacturing in India and taking up a minute more, it is not going to be only for the Indian market. Indian market, I think we are self-sufficient in terms of solar modules. We now need to create capacities for cells and wafers and other stuff. But the whole process has to be globally driven. When we have a program like ISA, we have to look at other countries, how we can export our material and our services from India for the global market. Africa is there for taking, Middle East is there for taking. And with a certain trust deficit that people have developed against China, I think this is going to be a very big opportunity. And it is upon us how fast we can take those.
Thank you. Thank you, Vinny. Very wonderful input. Mr. Shah, you can also include us as an EPC PRD if there are some better markets outside of India, just to get a little large perspective.
I will first answer your first question about implementation of smaller projects, one at 1 kilowatt and 2 kilowatt. See, people, in installation of solar projects, there are two type of costs. One is a capacity related cost, which is increasing with increase of capacity, like module cost or structure cost or like that, material cost. There are project specific costs, whether get an order, process subsidies, process the paperwork. So these are whether for 6 kilowatt project or 1 kilowatt project, the cost remains same. So naturally, in order to promote more 1 kilowatt and 2 kilowatt projects, number one, we have to have a special pricing for 1 kilowatt and 2 kilowatt projects. And number two, we have to reduce the project specific cost as far as possible by digitizing the process, like York said, minimal paperwork and minimal cost of getting the customer, the cost of getting the subsidy. So once we reduce the project specific cost, the cost of 1 kilowatt and 2 kilowatt become more competitive. So this is the answer number one for your question, how we can promote smaller capacity projects in the Gujarat, 1 kilowatt, 2 kilowatt. Second, for exporting our services and expertise to other countries. Yes, definitely, India is poised for a big growth in, say, Middle East and MENA region, Middle East and North America, North Africa, as well as Africa as a whole. We can make our mark because though the Chinese products are, Chinese are far ahead from us in terms of manufacturing, as far as EPC services are concerned, we are equally or better than, equally good or better than Chinese people in terms of providing our EPC services. You can see the case of Sterling and Wilson, you can see the case of L&T, and they are doing wonders in the Middle East and
initiatives, and one thing about the next two prerequisites for Gujarat to bounce back in the post-COVID era. So two which have worked till now and two which need to be.
Okay, thanks Vipul. Answering your first question, the top two initiatives which have did wonders for the solar industry is the government policy, first of all. Gujarat solar policy is, I think, one of the best in India, and including the smaller the startups, the new entrepreneurs. So that inclusion has helped the government to, you know, achieve the level which they have expected, or maybe more. So these are the best two initiatives taken by the government, and. Looking at the picture forward, many of the points has been covered in today's webinar, like what all things can boost up or what all things can help the path, the forward path. So the main thing is that digitalization is one of the most priority, like less human intervention is the need of an hour in the world. So that is the first thing which we need to focus on. And the second thing is proper campaigning and keep the positive attitude of the people and not, just look at the market in a negative way, but, keep to see the present opportunity, like looking at the anti-China sentiment which is going on right now. Just see the opportunity. By making the right decisions, then I think the path will follow itself. I think these are my closing remarks.
Thank you, Ishan. If you know, I'll run some questions now. Okay.
Please.
So here are the tools which will be on your screen.